I just want you to know we have someone who loves us. And that is down times when things aren't going well. We have one who wishes to bring us back into a place of fellowship with him forever, no matter how anything looks. And that through that, we can become more like him as well. Jesus, in Ephesians 1:5, says, having predestinated us into the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. We are part of God's kingdom. We're part of Jesus Christ. He has adopted us into the family. And now I just pray that this strengthens all of us. We just pray today for Pastor Jehle and the word that he's going to share with us, that it would bring life into our family. We look forward to what God is going to do in transforming us as his children. Lord, we pray for the worship. We pray that it ministers life, Lord God, your life, and that through it, your spirit would move in the hearts of men today. Lord, I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jim. And once again, everyone can be muted, but we're going to turn it over to Nathaniel, who is going to be able to share with us the worship team ministering as they have pre-recorded it.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. I sing for all that you've done for me. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free.
Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love.
That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be.
I sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Who the sun sets free, oh,
Oh,
Wonderful. What a blessing. Such a blessing. I don't know about you, but I just sat here so overwhelmed with thanksgiving that thank you so much, Heather. And even though Chuck Lindbergh and his family are away right now, we pray they are blessed as well. And also Heather, thank you so much for coordinating that. Wasn't that a blessing? Amen. And awesome to be able to join with our brothers and sisters in praise and thanksgiving. And once again, just keep yourself muted, but we have just a few that are going to share some updates. And Vinny and Jen DiMacedo, if you could unmute and just share with us a little bit about what God's been doing.
Amen. I mentioned just a little bit earlier because Jen Thompson had asked, but I had my surgery about 11 days ago and everything went well, just according to what they thought. So that's a relief to have that over, and meeting this next week with oncology and radiology and starting phase two. But I appreciate all the text messages, the dinners, the cards in the mail. It's just really important to both Vinny and I just to feel like we're surrounded with the love and support of all of you. And we appreciate that.
Amen. Praise God. And we love you guys and continue to pray for you. And pray also for your new job, Vinny, and how are things going?
Everything's going well. Fortunately, my job I can continue to do via Zoom. So I'm able to keep active, and that's good. And ultimately it ended up being pretty good for us as well, because with Jen being sick, I obviously didn't want to bring anything into the house. And so it's really worked out well for me. And but I do miss all of you. I miss seeing you weekly and being able to catch up and give you a handshake and a hug. And I hope we can get back to the point where we can do that, because that's important to all of us. As I said, just really love the fact that we can still see each other, though, despite the challenges that we've all been facing this last year.
Amen. Well, praise God. No, I appreciate that. And Russ Williams, are you on? Russ and Britt. Going to share a little update of a testimony as well.
I'm here. Let me turn the volume down, guys. So just a little quick praise. This past week, we had a medical incident that came up with one of our children. Adelie, our 4-year-old, was acting with some symptoms that were indicative of type 1 diabetes. And we're familiar with these symptoms. I have a niece who has type 1 diabetes, and all the symptoms she was exhibiting were very classic symptoms of that. We gave her a test to see if that was the case or not, and the test did come back positive, and showing that she in fact had type 1 diabetes. And so, you know, of course we were concerned, in prayer about it. This would, of course, is a very serious condition, could affect the rest of her life, and the rest of our family's life as well, of course. So we were in prayer about it. The next day we took her to the doctor to have her assessed, and the doctor gave her a test then, and it came back completely negative. Then we tested again, and it was completely negative. So it seems that even though all the indications were there that she in fact had it, and by the way, the test, the tests don't have false positives. Typically, it's not something that would just randomly show a positive. So we believe that God healed her, through the prayer and His power. And so we're very grateful for that.
Amen. We rejoice with you. Amen. Praise God. That's exciting. When we heard about that, we thought, wow, this is a testimony that would be encouraging, because our focus is on God. God is the same yesterday, today, forever, and yes. intervenes in our lives. So thank you so much, Russ, for sharing that, as challenging as that is. And I know that Ben and Haley, I think you are on, and share a little bit of what God's doing in your family.
Yeah, so Pastor Jehle asked Haley and I to share a little bit about a group that we've been having every Monday night at our place called Young Adults, a group of people ages 18 to 35. Pastor Dan's been heading it up, and I just want to give him a great thank you for that, because he's been a tremendous blessing putting, you know, things together week in and week out. Great topics for study. We've been doing it for about 6 months now. Had, you know, some pretty consistent numbers throughout the early stages. Now it's been kind of dwindling a little bit with the uncertainty of COVID and stuff, and people taking a little bit more precaution. But it's been a tremendous blessing to me seeing so many familiar faces and sometimes unfamiliar faces join. We've definitely been growing individually, Haley and I, throughout it. And I know a lot of other people have been touched by it as well. So we just hope that we can continue that ministry, be able to open up our home to other people as well, to have other people be able to hear the word of God. We've been reaching out to some people that aren't even believers, trying to get them to come in. And the thing about the young adults group is it's a very safe environment. It's not something where people are going to feel super pressured. You know, no one's ever pressured to say something. Pastor Dan does a good job about opening things up for discussion, letting everyone kind of share where they feel about the topic in their personal life or what they see. It's pretty cool to see the dialect between everybody and what everyone else has to share about. But I won't take the entire time to talk. I know Haley has a couple things to share as well. I could keep going on and on, so I'll let her share.
Well, I'm just going to talk a little bit about the structure and some of the things I appreciate. So rather than it being a Bible study where maybe you go through something pre-planned, Pastor Dan does have things set up, but we basically just read the Bible, which I really love. And we all turn to the passage in the Bible, we read it out loud, and then we expound on it. And it really just has allowed everybody an opportunity to, like Ben said, share when they feel led and interact. And rather than even having biases of, you know, maybe somebody who wrote a Bible study, we just get to go right to the word, which I've really appreciated. I've not really done that in a group setting too often anyway. And like Ben was saying, the environment, you know, it's in our house, and it just feels very safe to everybody who comes. Has been very consistent, like Ben said. And I've been able to invite a non-Christian. She's supposed to be coming tomorrow, although I'm not sure all the plans for tomorrow yet, but if we have it. So that's really exciting. And just pray that God continues to use the ministry and that people keep growing and keep coming. So it's definitely been a blessing to us.
Praise God. No, I appreciate that and appreciate you guys sharing. It's good to hear from one another and hear what God is doing in the midst of this. In that area. I don't want to put you on the spot, but I see you, Wayne Krause, there. Any updates on the prison ministry itself, or is that still on hold?
Well, it's still on hold right now. I talked to Danny, and he can't even go in and teach classes.
Right.
So until that opens up, we still can't go in there. So just keep praying for him and for the inmates in the offices.
Exactly.
And that the administration makes the right choices.
Amen. So we continue to do that, because there are obviously throughout these past few months, there are many ministries on hold, and we're all in that situation. And we're glad you guys are doing well. Krause is good to see, by the way. Great to see you folks. And so that's exciting. Praise God for that. Well, I'm going to prepare to share now, and I want to be able to, just as I get started with this, again, just make sure you're all muted individually, but I want to share a couple of things. Of course, Charlene and I have just come through about 14 days with COVID, And I remember I talked to many people who'd had COVID, and you never know what you're going to face. That no two people we know have the exact same symptoms, though there are some similarities. But I just want to share a couple of things about observations. One of the things Charlene and I kind of noticed after 2 or 3 days when we were knowing we had, of course, COVID and whatnot, is in spite of the three dominant things that, and there's all variety of this, being completely exhausted, sleeping all day and night, I just had no motivation to do anything. And all passion seemed to go. It's like drained right out of you. And that's not like me at all. I would keep checking myself and saying, what's wrong with you? What's going on here? And we recognized that we're fighting that. Just to kind of an idea, just go with the flow, doesn't really matter. Again, not something that our personalities are like. But one of the things I suppose that as a precursor to what I want to share here this morning, that we really sensed, and that I don't know that I was expecting it this way, is we sensed a real, like we were part of a massive global spiritual attack. It's like there was a spiritual element in this that really put us in tune with the fact that, wow, this is, and we would obviously knew the limits of God. Isn't it great to know that no matter what the enemy wants to do, God has him on a leash? He cannot do everything that he wants to do. The enemy, it's limited. And that's the blessing of God. And we were very conscious of that. We appreciate all the people who've been praying for us, of course, as well as the others that have been struggling. And even I've heard this said many times by people, you know me, I'm the eternal optimist in the sense, okay, this day, that's it. It's done. Now I'm ready. I can just go back and do my normal things, and then you suddenly go back 2 steps and you're back to struggling. But, you know, the beautiful thing about it is it really put us in tune with the fact that we're in a spiritual war, and we know that. It can be very easy rhetoric for us to simply say we're in a spiritual war. But I want to share with you some key thoughts that have been developing over several weeks. I actually was going to start this series of teaching on a Sunday morning, December 27. And you all know that I like to plan ahead. And I had everything planned ahead. And of course, nothing has happened the way I had planned it. But at the same time, I think that I want to just share a couple of things with you based on this. First of all, my remarks today and at least the next 4 Sundays, whether we're online or in person, I'm taking and borrowing a phrase that has become a very common phrase over the last 2 years, and that's called the Great Reset. And you may be familiar with this or not, but on the negative side, you must be aware of the fact that individuals who are globalists, who are internationalists, who feel like they're the closest to ever the controlling the world that they've seen before, have called this a Great Reset. They've boldly come out and said that the entire world will be reset, all nations, according to socialism and according to lots of tenets and these things. And that's not what I'm going to talk about today, what is being said necessarily, because the most important thing to recognize is there are patterns in the Bible. There are patterns that are so clear in Scripture that we need to focus on. Our focus cannot be on what the enemy's doing. Our focus should be on what God is doing and what God is trying to bring our focus to. This Great Reset, of course, you may be aware of Klaus Schwab's book, COVID-19, The Great Reset. And basically, organizations like the World Economic Forum, the United Nations, the Council on Foreign Relations, the Royal Institute for International Affairs, and some others have boldly come out and said, now is the time to reset all nations. And the interesting thing about it is, in speaking with some Christian economists and others, and I want to just use one illustration to introduce my main point. And then when I want to go to the scriptures, and the reason I have the Garden of Eden above me is not because I'm there. That'd be kind of nice, but that's not where I am. It's because I want to speak a bit about what happened in the Garden of Eden as a very good pattern for what God wants us to focus on right now. But the interesting thing is one world economist, very well known, I'll put it this way. He said that normally in the world, when there are major events like we've experienced, it takes 10, 15, maybe 20 years for nations to adjust to the changes that are taking place worldwide. But he said, think of it this way. What COVID has done is has taken what would be normally a 10 to 15 year change and put it into 10 to 15 months. And if you think about it that way, forcing whole economies and nations and governments into reacting to things in a very short time period. And this has been a very, very difficult thing. One thing I want to just use as an illustration and an introduction is the area of debt. It's not being talked about much, but it, I think you and I can relate to this. Most of you know that if you are, that there are standard ratios that if you go to a bank and you want to borrow money, you want to buy a house, you want to deal with it, they to look at a ratio between your income and your debt. And as they say all the time, that ideally you don't want to borrow, you don't want to have any kind of borrowing more than 70% of your stable income. You obviously don't want to borrow more than you make because that's a recipe for disaster, but you want to make sure that you're in a place where 70% is like the top threshold. It's interesting that in the past few months, the United States itself and the world has gone through a cataclysmic area. We're now in a zone that the world's never seen. The world's never seen every single nation on the face of the globe in drowning in debt. The United States has now reached 140% of its gross domestic product, which means our debt is double what the highest you would have at any individual level. It is astronomically high. Japan is at 250%. Now I say this all because here's the interesting thing about it. We might think that individuals who want evil and want all the things that are we wouldn't want are so powerful. They're terrified. They've never been in this situation. This is a situation which is very, very dangerous for all the nations economically. But I want you to look at it this way and recognize that do you know that the ratio of debt for individuals, if you would report it out proportionately, is the same as nations? In other words, we're not doing anything different at the international level than unfortunately we've been doing at the personal level. Now, here's my point. God knows this. God has designed everything that he has made from the very beginning with this ratio in mind. Do you know that what happens in our hearts eventually is going to make an impact downstream, so to speak, generations from now? God's focus is to try to get us as the people of God to look at the things that he sees are most important, which is our heart. It's our own motive, our own responsibility. I want to address a simple situation about responsibility. I believe that whatever is going on at the international level on the Great Reset is nothing compared to what God is doing with a great reset in the body of Christ. This nothing has happened by surprise to God. God is at work internationally, worldwide, in many nations with his people and his church. And he's tweaking his church. He's adjusting us. We cannot escape it. It's not something we can just say, oh, I'll just pretend it doesn't exist. No, God is getting our attention because his goal is to bring us into a greater owning of responsibility. It is really true that decisions I make today that I take responsibility for, and if I become irresponsible, will affect other people down the road generationally. And it is something that God wants to bring our attention to. I want you to go back to the Garden of Eden with me and just let's look at this for just a moment. Just like that little illustration of debt, where the whole world is facing something they've never faced as a world economically. And yet it still ties into individually how people are often being irresponsible in how they deal with their own personal debt. I want you to look back at the Garden of Eden for a moment and recognize this. Think about God's initial default setting. I recently got a new phone, and I did not look forward to reprogramming a new phone. I didn't like the first program to begin with. I'm not that good at that kind of stuff. But you all know the fact of this. I was in a store with a gentleman who was helping me, and he said this: "Do you want me to just go back to the default setting?" Now, I understand what that means. That means go back to the factory setting from the very beginning. That scared me because I don't want to have to start recreating and putting in all the apps and all that kind of stuff. He said, no, I'll do all that for you. But I thought of it this way. There was a default setting that God made, and in the Garden of Eden. And before sin entered the human race, think about it. In the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve, when God had created it, before sin came in, what kind of default setting had God given us? There was individual choice of what you were going to work on in the garden. There was productivity. Adam and Eve worked as a team together. There was liberty. There was freedom. They had a limited area where they knew one tree they couldn't touch. They couldn't eat of it. They exaggerated it to not even touch it. But the idea was there was freedom. There was no racism in the Garden of Eden at the time. There was no phobias. There were no problems like that. This was the great default of the human race. And then sin entered. We know in Genesis chapter 3, when the enemy came to tempt Eve and Adam, that we recognize something occurred. And that sin meant that we were going to shirk responsibility. And notice what happened. God comes and he comes to Adam and he said, what's wrong, Adam? Have you done what I told you not to do? And Adam said, it's the woman you gave me. It's the woman you gave me. That's the problem. Don't come to me. It's not my fault. He started the blame game. It's her issue. Well, then God goes to Eve and says, Eve, what's the problem? What did Eve do? It's the serpent. It's not me. It's the serpent. It's the devil. The devil made me do it. And of course, God didn't go questioning the devil. He just began bringing judgment. But there was something that happened there. I want you to understand this. This was the big reset. The enemy wanted to reset the entire human race against God. He couldn't do it without the cooperation of Adam and Eve. He couldn't just do it to them. He had to trick them into giving him permission. But immediately, God knew it from the beginning. Do you know, God from the very beginning knew what he was going to do to reset what the enemy had done. And in Genesis 3:15, we find this prophetic declaration. I'll put enmity between you, that's Eve, and you talked about it, and the seed of the woman, between you and the woman, between your seed and her seed, he shall bruise your head. And it goes on to say, and you shall bruise his heel. In other words, notice, looking forward to the seed of the woman, he prophesies of the coming of Christ right there in the Garden of Eden, that he will bruise your head, devil. Yes, you'll bruise his heel. He'll die on a cross. He will give his life. But there's a reset. In other words, whatever the enemy wanted to do to bring total bondage, division, enmity between people, it all started in the garden with sin. God had a reset. He had a great reset that he was going to do, and it culminated in the coming of Christ. Christ was the great reset. He's going to say, whatever the enemy wanted to do to bring bondage to people, control from the outside, all the wars and all the things that divide people, God was going to reset it. And I want to read from Luke 4:18-19, which is a quote from Isaiah 61. This was why Jesus came. And you'll know it. It said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, or the idea, of course, of the year of Jubilee. Now here, when we look at this, we see the following. What did Jesus do? This is the total opposite. He did not come for just the rich. He did not come for just the powerful. He came to the brokenhearted. He came to the poor. He came to the individual. God reset and overturned what the enemy was going to do by coming in the opposite way that they never would have dreamed, to come to those that, as individuals, to an individual responsibility, to say, listen, I can redeem you from within. When you come to know me, when you give your heart to me, when you say, Lord, I know that I cannot do all that you've asked me to do on my own. I've got to give it to you. It is the rudiment of liberty. It comes in individual hearts. And then it moves out beyond that. And it goes far beyond. And it affects cultures. It affects nations. It affects others downstream, we might say. See, God has already got a recipe for this. So what might God be doing today in light of this? How is God desiring to shift his people's perspective so that we see responsibility? I want to say this to you, as nice as I can say it to myself and others. It is so important for us right now to reject the distraction of blaming everything that we see on the humanist, on the atheist, on the devil, on the globalist, on the individual that wants to take away liberty. Folks, the blame game is not going to work. This is not the problem. Our problem as the body of Christ right now is not what's happening on the outside. It's not what's happening at the political level. The problem is us. God wants to tweak our hearts so that our response is, Lord, expose me. Lord, show me where I need to take greater responsibility. Show me where I need to take responsibility for the attitudes in my heart, knowing they will have great impact even worldwide, eventually, at some point. We're not in control of those things. We can't take responsibility for everything on the outside and changing it all. We can't do that. What we can do is what God has told us to do. And that is to look at it this way. Think about it. The Bible has said in Psalm 115, the heaven, even the heavens are the Lord's, but the earth he has given to the children of men. We have a responsibility before God to keep our hearts in a place of brokenness before God. That will bless the earth. In fact, in Psalm 33, it says, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people he has chosen for his own inheritance. How does God bless a nation? Through the condition of his people. It's the body of Christ, the church, all of us that need to say, Lord, I need to take responsibility for my own heart. I need to tend my own garden. I need to tend the responsibilities you have given me for my heart before you, for my children, my grandchildren, whatever it is that I can do. Lord, you put my focus on the responsibility you've given me so that I am not constantly just looking and saying, I can't believe what they just did. I can't believe what just happened over here. I can't believe that. No, Lord, you help me take that responsibility. It's interesting that in Proverbs 4:23, we read that out of the heart flow all the issues of life. It comes from the internal to the external. Notice in Isaiah 58, when God said to his people, take responsibility for the right kind of fast that will truly bless the nation. I'm just going to read some excerpts here. He says, is this not the fast that I have chosen, to loose the bands of wickedness, undo the heavy burdens, let the oppressed go free, that you break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry, that you bring to your house the poor who are cast out? When you see the naked, that you cover them, that you not hide yourself even from your own flesh. Then your light shall break forth like the morning. Your healing will spring forth speedily. Your righteousness shall go before you. Take away the yoke from your own midst. The pointing of the finger, that's the blame. The speaking of wickedness. And then you will become a watered garden, a spring of water whose waters do not fail. Those from among you shall build the old waste places, shall raise up foundations of many generations. You shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of the streets to dwell in. In other words, God is saying this to us today. The first area of reset, I think, that God wants to get our attention on is that of responsibility. It's not the devil. It's not global government, COVID, secret societies, or any of those things that are the root of our problem. The problem is the heart of God's people. Oh, Lord, would you have us our heart so that we would love our enemies? We would even go to our nth degree to say, God, break my heart that I might take greater responsibility for the things you've already shown me in my heart. Lord, may all that's happening break me to a greater level that I might walk with you with deeper commitment and surrender to you. Lord, that's all I can be responsible for. I can't be responsible for everything else, but I can be responsible for what you're telling me to deal with in my own heart. And what are some of those things that God has said? Prayer. We pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We need to recognize that we're not asking. Jesus could come anytime, but we're not asking Jesus to come to get us out of this mess. We're asking, Lord God, your kingdom would come in the midst of this. His kingdom is coming. Do you know that there are tremendous testimonies of the church of Jesus Christ in some of the poorest nations of the world that have gone through things you cannot imagine that with this COVID and the pandemic? And yet those believers are impacting people in phenomenal ways because they're taking responsibility for what God has talked to them in their hearts. That's where our focus needs to be. We need to be the salt of the earth. We need to serve. And look, where are ways in which we can serve in our neighborhoods, in our communities? God, help us to keep that focus and walk in the light. Lord, help us to walk in the light. You know, the Bible tells us that our good works are a light that light people to give glory to God. Lord, help us in focusing in those areas to take the right responsibility and not merely get caught up in the blame of this one and that one and the other thing. No, turn our eyes on God and what he wants to do, to walk in forgiveness. Lord, help me to release forgiveness. Help me to walk and be forgiven from you for the sin I hold in my heart, but also release it to others. You know, I've been pondering Acts 3:19-21, and here's the second sermon of Peter in the early church. The first one, he said, whosoever will, let him come. The second one, I want to highlight this. It says the following. Repent, be converted, that your sins might be blotted out, so that the times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, that he may send Jesus Christ, who was preached to you before, whom heaven must retain until the times of the restoration of all things which God has spoken by the mouth of his prophets. He said this, listen, Peter was preaching to them and saying, look, Jesus has already gone into heaven and the heavens must retain him. He must remain there until the proper time of the restoration of all things. And I think of this. I think times of refreshing from the Lord. Don't you think? This is so unprecedented, folks. The whole world is now hungering for revival, for awakening. But can you imagine the Lord beginning to rain righteousness across the face of the globe in all kinds of nations? I look at this and say, Lord, may the times of refreshing come from you, because the contrast is so great. Help me, Lord, not to focus on the external as much as the internal and what you're doing in my heart to prepare me, Lord, for this kind of thing. What kind of posture could I take? Obviously, as you know, I've just finished teaching Bible studies on the book of Daniel, Bible studies on what God is saying in the midst of all that we see happening around us. I have been rereading Daniel chapter 9 and recognizing that God is saying, listen, when Daniel, after the 70 years were up, he knew Jeremiah's letter was accurate, that now they were going to be released, and at least a portion of his people would be able to return. And yet Daniel took a posture as an intercessor, took a posture and said, Lord, even though I didn't commit all of these things, I'm not the one that brought the nation into captivity. I mean, he was one of the few remnant teenagers that were standing for God. But I'm going to take that posture and say, Lord, we have sinned. Lord, we have sinned. God, we have not done what you've wanted us to do. We have not given you every aspect of our hearts. We have not given you those areas where we've gotten angry. I found myself getting angry at things that I see. And yes, there's righteous indignation, there's righteous anger, but not the kind that I need to be broken before God, to say, God, what are you doing for me taking responsibility for the things in my heart? I want to read to you excerpts from Daniel chapter 9. I encourage you to read this on your own during the week and say, God, what are you asking for me to do? And this is what Daniel said. In the first year of the reign of Darius, Daniel, I understood by the books, by the number of years specified by the word of the Lord through Jeremiah the prophet, that he would accomplish 70 years in the desolations of Jerusalem. So I set my face toward the Lord God to make request by prayer and supplication, with fasting, with sackcloth, with ashes. I prayed to the Lord my God and made confession, and this is what I said. O Lord God, great and awesome Lord, who keeps his covenant and mercy with those who love him and with those who keep his commandments, we have sinned. We've committed iniquity. We have done wickedly and rebelled, even by departing from your precepts and your judgments. Neither have we heeded your servants, the prophets, who spoke in your name to our kings and our princes, to our fathers and all the people of our land. O Lord, righteousness belongs to you, to us shame of face. As it is this day, to the men of Judah, to the inhabitants of Jerusalem and all Israel, those near and those far off in all the countries to which you have driven them, because of the unfaithfulness which they have committed against you. O Lord, to us belongs shame of face, to our kings, our princes, our fathers, because we have sinned against you. To the Lord our God belongs mercy and forgiveness, though we have rebelled against him. We have not obeyed the voice of the Lord to walk in his laws, which he has set before us. Yes, all Israel has transgressed your law, departed so as not to obey your voice. Therefore, the curse and the oath written in the law of Moses, the servant of God, have been poured out on us because we have sinned against him. And he has confirmed his words, which he spoke against us and our judges who judged us, by bringing upon us a great disaster. For under the whole heaven, such has never been done as what has been done to Jerusalem. And as this is written in the law of Moses, all this disaster has come upon us, yet we have not made our prayer before the Lord our God, that we might turn our iniquities and understand your truth. Therefore, the Lord has kept the disaster in mind and brought it upon us, for the Lord our God is righteous in all his works which he does, though we have not obeyed his voice. And now, O Lord God, who brought your people out of the land of Egypt with a mighty hand, you made yourself a name as it is this day, but we have sinned. We have done wickedly. O Lord, according to your righteousness, let your anger and fury be turned away from your city, your holy mountain, because of our sins and for the iniquities of our fathers. Jerusalem and your people are a reproach to all those around us. Now, therefore, our God, hear the prayer of your servant, his supplications, and for the Lord's sake, cause your face to shine on your sanctuary, which is desolate. Oh, my God, incline your ear. Hear, open your eyes, see our desolations in the city which is called by your name. For we do not present our supplications before you because of any of our righteous deeds, but because of your great mercies. Lord, hear. Lord, forgive. Lord, please listen. Lord, act. Do not delay for your own sake. For your city and your people are called by your name. You know, I think of it this way, folks. I think of it. Our nation is in shambles. The protection has come down. God has allowed this. We now flaunt the fact of passing bills of infanticide. We now flaunt the fact of being against God. We flaunt areas of persecution, of the unrighteous. We make excuses, and even in the body of Christ, we make excuses for the racism that still does exist, for the areas of wickedness that still exist in our nation. You and I need to come to God and recognize and say, God, no more blame. I'm not blaming the enemy. I'm not blaming any of those. God, you are righteous. You are holy. You could stop them at any moment. You could turn the heart of a king like you turn the waters of God. Lord, let us come before you and take responsibility in the spirit and say, God, we ask you, break our hearts. Help us to come closer to you, Lord, that this be our focus. Lord, we don't need a minor makeover in our nation any longer. We need an overhaul. We need a complete fumigation. We need a complete overhaul from the ground up, from your people up. Therefore, we could say, Lord God, we come before you and we ask you, may the great reset not be our focus internationally, but the great reset of your tweaking your people's heart to come before you in complete humility and say, God, without you, I think you all can agree, without the Lord moving on behalf of his own mercy and righteousness, we are not going to be able to save the nation, to change it. Our answer is not political. The answer is not in the halls of Congress. The answer is in the halls of the hearts of God's people and in the moving of the mercy of God. Without God, there is no hope. And you and I have to come to that place and we'd say, and so Lord, help me take responsibility for the areas you're revealing in my heart, with my neighborhood, with my area. And Lord, may I come before you in total brokenness. I was thinking about this, you know, it's not that Christianity has been looked at in the nation and tried and said, see, it doesn't work. No, it's because true Christianity has not been allowed to manifest in through the hearts of God's people. Folks, I'm telling you, when the world sees the true love of Christ coming forth from his church, regardless of the consequences, when we have that sin and iniquity broken down and the light of Christ comes forth, the massive difference is going to be so powerful. It is so amazing. This is what God does. Look, I read the same things you do, folks. I'm distraught. I'm disappointed. I'm at a place, but I need to say, God, take me to the place of true brokenness before you, that I would truly see the sin that has brought us to this place and repent from it in my own heart. And then, then we will be able to see that God's plan of resetting responsibility back to where it began, just like in the Garden of Eden, is the way God wants to deal with this situation. So the answer is not a political one. I look at it as spiritual. I look at it with anticipation. I believe we need to be expectant that God is going to move in our own hearts in ways we never expected. And what we're going to see is a tremendous, and I pray sooner than later, but I pray a phenomenal, massive awakening and revival that is going to come through the hearts of God's people and might be surprising to us, because our focus cannot be on all the people that we think have done all this wrong. No, we have sinned. Let's take the posture of Daniel and not the posture of any kind of blame. Amen? God is great, God is good, and God is the one that's going to be our solution. Amen? Praise God. You can